My name is Max Strauss, and with me today is Mike Pettine, the defensive coordinator of the New York Jets. Make sure you stop by my website, prointerviews.org. Anyways, let's get started on the interview. Alright, so when did you start playing football? Like, where did you play? What positions? How natural did it come for you? And what was your dad's reaction to playing football?
Well, it was funny because my dad was a coach. So I tried to play when I was 8 and didn't like it. You know, I played offensive line on the 65-pound team, you know, this little town called Warrington, Warrington, just outside of the town where I grew up, which is Doylestown, Pennsylvania. And I didn't like it at all. It was a bad experience. And so when the year was over, I mean, he was fine. I didn't want to, you know, I just didn't like it. So it was one of those things where it took me a couple of years, and then I started to play again. I want to say 2 or 3 years later, and it was much more natural for me then, and much more enjoyable, and I just took off with it. You know, ever since, I ended up, you know, playing for my dad, and then went to Virginia, played there, mm-hmm. And then when I finished school, it was just a natural transition for me to get into coaching. I never realized while I was going to school, you know, I wish I had, that I was going to get into coaching. It was far from, it was the last thing I wanted to do. And, sure enough, it was, my last season ended in Virginia, and when the next fall came and something was missing, so I naturally got into it. In high school, I played quarterback, and I played safety. Mm-hmm. And then when I went to college, I actually started out as a quarterback and was a backup for 2 years, and then got switched over and started at safety for 2 years. So those were pretty much my main two positions throughout my career.
What was it like to have your dad coach the football team? Did you get made fun of at all for, like, your dad coaching the high school team?
Well, it's great now because of, I think, everything I absorbed while I was, growing up. But I'm not going to lie, when I was playing for him, I don't want to say, it probably wasn't the most pleasant experience in the world. I mean, and he was a very tough coach, very strict, real hard on the team. So a lot of the guys, you know, when they got mad at him, you know, I was their only outlet to take it out on, you know, especially when I was a sophomore. So, I had my share of, getting baby powder dumped on me and, you know, equipment going missing and that type of stuff, you know, just regular hazing type stuff when I was a 10th grader, and then obviously that didn't happen later on. But, it was tough, but at the same time, because it was one of the typical things, you know, when you coach your kid, that you want to make sure that people understand that you're not showing favoritism or anything like that. And that's what made it hard. He was so tough on me.
So did you get a nickname in high school?
Everybody called me Junior, mm-hmm. just because he and I have the same first name. So he was always Mike Pettine Senior. I was Mike Pettine Junior. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because for a while it was Big Mike, Little Mike, and then I got bigger than him. So then it was, it just ended up, everybody called me Junior or JR.
What was, like, your best experience from playing high school football? We'll talk about college at UVA. How hard was it to, like, choose UVA to go to play football there?
It really wasn't. I mean, the one thing that I think that, you know, my parents wanted to make sure is that I went to a good school. You know, my dad had always used the phrase with his players, it's not a 4-year decision, it's a 40-year decision. I mean, this is going to, you have to go make the decision based on, you never play a down of football. football. You just have to make that assumption that something could happen. So you got to make sure that you make it, that you're making the choice for school, not for football. So my final two choices were actually Duke and Virginia, and I chose Virginia just because of geography. It was just closer to home. And I you know, it was one of those things where I enjoyed my time there and got a good education and look back very fondly on my time there.
What was it like to play football under George Welsh?
George was, it's funny because he had just come from the Naval Academy. I think 1982 was his last year there. So it was funny because in 84, he was still slipping up and, you know, he'd call it the mess hall. And, you know, he would say, you know, he wouldn't say wake up, you know, he would say reveille, you know, we'll be at, 06, whatever, you know, so we used to laugh at it. You know, he had a hard time letting his military, his naval stuff go, but, George is good. George is very meticulous, very organized, and as a coach, I mean, it helped me out, you know, down the road, having played for him, to see that, to see his degree of organization and how he interacted with the staff and how he interacted with the team. That's the one thing that was very fortunate. I've been around a lot of great coaches that have had a lot of different methods, and I feel like I've been able to draw the positives from all of them.
So, how'd you get really started in coaching, though?
Well, I finished in college. I knew I wasn't going to play professionally. I just started to work. I took a job, you know, just a normal, you know, job. I was working at Prudential Life Insurance and, you know, in their home office, and something was missing. And that fall rolled around. I don't know whether it was the smell of the cut grass or whatever it was, but something was just missing. And I quickly realized that it was football. So, fortunately, where it was located, it was like a big business park. Like, there's a lot of businesses there, so they had encouraged all the companies to kind of flex their hours so there wouldn't be as much traffic heading in and out of that one area, you know, twice a day. So I had the option to work from 7 to 3, which was great for me because I could work at 7. I could be off at 3, be at the high school by 3:30. So I just started to help my dad out kind of part-time. You know, I was video scouting for him and going up and just kind of helping out his young kids, you know, the young quarterbacks and his young defensive backs. And I just took to it right away. I mean, it was a natural, it really was a natural thing for me.
When you coached, like, your own football team, what was that whole experience like?
Yeah, it was actually 10 years ago when I was at North Penn High School. I was a high school head coach 3 different places. First one was called William Tennant. That's in Warminster, Pennsylvania, and then the second place was North Penn High School. And I had a great experience at both schools. I mean, I really enjoyed working with the kids. It's the one thing about, you know, because I've coached at all 3 levels, you know, high school, college, and professionally, high school's where you feel like you have the most impact, you have the most influence on a player. Sometimes you get them in college, or obviously you get them in the NFL. They've been around for a long time. You know, coaching is less of an impact, whereas high school, I mean, it's much more pure coaching, I think, than anywhere else. It's very, very rewarding.
What was it like to be a graduate assistant at Pittsburgh when you coached there?
To me, that was a real positive thing as well. No, results-wise, I mean, we weren't very good. I think I want to say we were 3-8. In both the years that I was there, but it was a good coaching staff. I mean, I was surrounded by some really good coaches there. Johnny Majors, the obvious one, being the head coach, and was fortunate to get the graduate assistant job through Chuck Drisbach, Drisbach. I think he's at Rice now, but he's been a bunch of places. But he played for my dad. That was the connection there. He'd actually been one of my dad's players in the late 60s, early 70s. So he gave me a break there. I also worked I worked with Jack Henry, who was one of the long time, very successful line coaches in the NFL. Tim Lewis, who's still in the league, I believe. I think he's with Atlanta now. But he was a defense coordinator with the Steelers. He was a secondary coach of the Steelers. He was with the Seahawks. Was with the Giants as a coordinator. I mean, Tim was very successful. I learned a lot of football from Tim. And then actually there, I was fortunate enough to meet Matt Cavanaugh, who after my high school career was coaching career was done, because he's the one that I was in was with the Ravens that I contacted that that got me in the door. So it was at Pittsburgh that actually made the contact that got me into the NFL.
Do you play fantasy football? Have you ever wanted to play fantasy football with an NFL player? Well, now you can. Go to prointerviews.org/FFL and you can find out how to win Isaiah Ekajuba, the special team ace for the Detroit Lions, autographed jersey. And now, let's get back to the interview with Mike Pettine Jr. Yeah, speaking of like when you first got into the NFL, though, what was that all like?
It was definitely an eye-opening experience. Now, my first year, I actually was not an on-the-field coach. I was, as I said, I got my foot in the door through Matt Cavanaugh, who was the offensive coordinator at the time. But the position that I got was more of a technical one. I was off the field. I was the third person in the video department, so I was in charge of all the special teams video. And then at the time, you know, Brian Billick had come from Minnesota. He'd used Macintosh computers there, and Baltimore was transitioning to they wanted to all be on an IBM platform. So Brian had about 6,000 playbook drawings that he needed converted from this Mac format, this Mac drawing program, to this IBM based program that the Ravens had decided to use, and they wanted for it to still maintain the ability to edit them. So they needed somebody to come in. Because the IT department there basically had their own workload. Since this was just a one-time thing, they wanted to bring somebody in to do that project as well. So that was one of my, in addition to the video department, I did that project for the playbook drawings as well. And then at night, it helped me just to be around at night, because then that way I could help out, while all my other work was done. I could just help out the coaching staff if they had any kind of overflow. Quality control type work, and what was great for me is, from a career standpoint, when I walked in the door, there are the three guys that I'm working with closely, the closest are end up all being future head coaches in the NFL. Mike Nolan was defense coordinator. Mike Smith, now head coach of the Falcons, was the linebackers coach, and Rex was the defensive line coach, and those were the three guys that I really worked with the closest, and then was just kind of thrown with Rex. He really didn't have somebody working with him, so he and I were just kind of thrown in a room together, and there was just instant chemistry there. I think it's funny when I look back on that, but because it was almost by default that I ended up working with him.
Like, what was it like to work with Rex with the D-line and everything, and then when you were promoted the linebackers coach, what was the transition like?
Like 03 and 04, I was the defensive line assistant, so Rex and I were kind of ran the D line, stuff together. I assisted him, with all the drill work, everything in the meetings, all that stuff. And then in 2005, when he got promoted to coordinator, I'm kind of what I did for Rex was a lot of the computer stuff, a lot of the organizational stuff. I had the title of outside linebackers. But I was still really working as his assistant as well. So I did a lot of the organizational stuff for the defense, which I did that from 05 all the way up to when I left after Baltimore after the 2008 season. So it was great working experience for me to work hand in hand with the coordinator, and it made it just such an easy transition when Rex became the head coach here. Mm-hmm. That I stepped into the coordinator's role, and like I said, I just feel like I was very well prepared for it because I'd been doing so many of those similar jobs for years.
So how much of your success do you give to Rex Ryan?
I can't say enough about what a positive impact he's had on me as a person and as a coach. Like I said, when I looked at all the great coaches that I've been around, I would say my dad has had the biggest influence on me, but I'd have to put Rex up there as a close second. And it's funny because those two, I don't think, could be, like, personality-wise, just almost like opposite ends of the spectrum. My dad, your traditional old school, whereas and then there's Rex, you know, on the other end of it, where it's more easygoing, fun, love, and shoot from the hip. You know, go ahead and put a bullseye on your chest, you know, high expectations, all that stuff. So it's funny that I've learned the most from two guys that have such contrasting styles. But like I said, Rex was just such a huge part of, as I tell people, you know, I hitched my wagon to the right guy. Because I knew right away when I met him that he was special, and that he was, you know, that it was only a matter of time before he got his break. And you know, I felt like I wanted to be there. Obviously, wanted to be there with him when it happened.
What's been the best part of your relationship with Rex Ryan?
I just think it's running defense together. Just the interaction, the sharing of ideas, you know, getting on the whiteboard and you know, hashing out a defense and, you know, what works good and what doesn't, how do we want to roll it out, just that whole, the implementation of a plan, and then seeing it work, and just being there together and having the ability, because the one thing I think that's unique about our relationship, and then people laugh about it when they kind of see us interact, is we're almost like brothers. Like, you know, I'm not afraid. You know, he's not afraid. He'll say anything to me, I'll say anything to him. I mean, we're both competitive. We're both prideful guys. So if there's something wrong, you know, I'm not afraid to say something to him. And if there's, you know, if I did something wrong, then Rex certainly isn't afraid to let me know. And sometimes we get after each other pretty good. And, you know, people will ask us after a game, hey, you guys okay? And we laugh because, you know, we'll be, you know, we'll hardly even remember what we said to each other. But it's just, I just think it's unique that way. Some guys get very guarded, and sometimes during, you know, you take things, you get sensitive, or you take things too personal. And Rex and I we're all about one thing, and I think that's one of the reasons we work well together. Is that we're both very passionate about football, and we both ultimately know that it all comes down to one thing, and that's winning the ring.
What were some of the toughest and like the easiest challenges when you had to implement the new defense in New York, and what was it like to also bring Bart Scott, Jim Leonard, and Marquise Douglas to New York to help you with the system?
Well, I think the biggest challenge last year was just to implement the new system. Is to take it, you know, a group of players that really had no idea, you know, their style of defense here, you know, and you know, there's a lot of different ways and a lot of different styles, and what was best for what Eric Mangini felt, what was best for them, they ran, and what he was familiar with. But, you know, Rex and I, you know, have a certain philosophy how we want to do things. It was very different, so it was not just putting in a new playbook, but I think it was also a different mentality as well, and not be so much read and react, and we wanted to be much more aggressive and you know, and pressure and you know, and give our guys a little bit more freedom as far as some of the things they could do within the structure of the defense. So, I think it was difficult from a teaching standpoint to kind of change the culture, change the mentality. But the one thing I can say, and to me it's a credit to Eric Mangini, it's a credit to Mike Cannonbaum, is that the group of players that were here, we weren't that far away from, we knew it when we first got here. It's like, hey, you know, the cupboard's not bare. I mean, we got some pretty good football players. And we talk about a set of attributes that we want all of our players have. We call it play like a jet. You know, and it's being passionate, tough, productive, you know, relentless, you know, play like your hair's on fire, that type of mentality. And most of our guys had that. And it was a very, very smart group. So they picked up the system right away. So we were fortunate that we got a bunch of meeting time in the spring with our camps, and then we had able to install it again at training camp. But this was a group that picked it up very quickly. And then we also had the advantage too, as you already talked about, to bring in three players who had played for us in Baltimore. You know, the one that people don't really remember, don't think about, is Marcus Douglas, who just ironically signed with the Dolphins. With the defensive line, we had Bart Scott at the linebackers and Jim Leonard with the defensive backs. And I think that was real big for us, not just for an X's and O's thing, but more for, hey, this is how we practice. This is how we prepare. This is our mentality. mentality. They were, we had a guy in each area of the defense that could kind of set that tone for us, and I think that was a key part of our success was having those three guys that the rest of the guys on defense could lean to, you know, as an example.
Do you have a Facebook account? Well, if so, join the Facebook page at facebook.com/prointerviews. There, you can find announcements and other important information of when new interviews come out. Just click like. And now, let's get back to the interview with Mike Pettine Jr. The Jets also made a lot of offseason moves this past year. The D-line added Vernon Golston, and so he's now on the defensive line. The linebackers now have Jason Taylor. So, and then the secondary, they got rid of Kerry Rhodes, but we also added Kyle Wilson, Antonio Cromartie, and Bronny Poole. And I think Bronny Poole is actually one of the most underrated pickups since I saw what he did in Cleveland, and he...
Yeah, we're very excited about Bronny. I think he's going to have I don't know if he'll be a spectacular guy for us, but... He'll make some plays, he'll do his job, and I think he's going to be a valuable part. I don't think people realize, but he's going to be a big part of our success this year.
Which group, like line, linebackers, and secondary, do you think has improved the most this offseason?
Well, I just think you probably have to say the defensive backs, and that's more just because of the upgrade in personnel. We feel... That Rodney's going to do a good job for us. He stepped right in the spring and picked things up right away. And then Antonio Cromartie just has the ability to have a guy that's been to a Pro Bowl, that's had 12 interceptions in a year, that has his type of man cover skills. It's just a tremendous thing for us to add that we have a guy that plays ours. There's different styles of defense. He's not real well suited to be an off-the-ball zone corner. In our style, it is, get up in your face. Let's take advantage of that first five-yard contact rule that we have. And let's lock guys down. And, we're fortunate that we have guys that can play man coverage here. We drafted one also in Kyle Wilson, who we think has a chance to be a real good player as well. So I just think the back end has... is not only we've upgraded personnel-wise, but I think they had a good spring, too, just as far as the communication back there. That was one of our issues last year. When we gave up some negative plays, a lot of times it wasn't necessarily what our opponent did. It was a mistake that we made, and that was a big part of our offseason was, addressing those issues and looking at, hey, listen, well, we've given up play. There are times in this league where you'll say, hey, listen, that was a good throw, a good catch, nothing you can do. There were a lot of times where the wounds that we had were self-inflicted, and that's one of our big goals this year is to get a lot of those things cleaned up because a lot of them, and it's only natural in the first year of a defense, a lot of them ended up being communication things, and that's where I think this year that our guys have really taken the next step, kind of going that was we preached to them in the spring. Let's go. We understand the basics of the defense now. And we had the success that we had, we can be so much better. Let's go ahead and take it more to a graduate level. To understand more of the ins and outs, the intricacies of it. And I think our guys have bought into that, and I think that really showed up during our spring workouts. It was one of those things where our guys understand it, but I don't think it was more like last year was an introductory course, whereas I think this year we can get into more. We can delve into some deeper things and some deeper concepts that we weren't able to get taught the first year because a lot of our stuff too was just learning. Hey, let's just get lined up. How do I get lined up? What technique am I playing? Whereas now, our defensive linemen, they line up in a certain front. They understand. Okay, this is how teams are going to block it. These are the types of blocks I can expect. Whereas before it was, hey, let's just get lined up and go. And I think now. Our guys understand better, how teams are going to attack us.
So how does the reuniting with Mark Carrier help the defense, and what does he bring to the Jets?
Well, he brings that, the mentality that we talked about. I mean, he's proof of, the whole play like a Jet mentality, that he's passionate, he's a tough guy. I mean, I think league in fine money for illegal hits when he was playing in Chicago. He jokes, I think if he came out of retirement, I think he would still owe two game checks to the commissioner. So, you know, he brings an attitude, you know, a toughness, and a great example of a guy that's done it. You know, it's great to have on your staff guys that played in the league that can relate to the players and they know what the player's going through. Whereas, you know, somebody like myself or some of our other coaches that never played, you know, we just don't have that insight. So it's great to have somebody like Mark. Plus, since he came from Baltimore, he was with us for a bunch of years there. He understands how we do things, you know, the daily routine stuff and the, you know, how things get taught and certain drills that are universal throughout the defense. He understands all those things. So while people looked at it on the surface as, well, it's a strange move to take a guy who's a career defensive back as a player and career defensive back coach. You know, in my opinion, a good coach can coach any position. And you know, it was great. I think it was a good move for Mark. And he was excited about it, and it was obviously a win for us as well to get somebody, you know, that's one of our kind of guys up here to New York.
All right. Just a couple more questions. So,
sure.
For the people that want to go into coaching or even playing football, what's the best advice you can give them?
Well, the one thing about it is, you know, the advice that I'd given young coaches that you know, some guys sometimes get too tied up in, you know, looking for that next job, always looking, because there's, you know, there's people think, okay, you know, progress. I'm going to go from high school, I'm going to go from position coach to coordinator. I'm going to go from this high school to that high school. I'm going to go from high school to college. There's all that information out there. Okay, what jobs are going to open? And sometimes guys get too wrapped up in that. And the phrase that I had always used was don't look for a better job, do a better job. A lot of times in this business, if you do good work, the jobs will find you. You won't necessarily have to seek them out. I mean, it's a very low percentage that you're just going to randomly send out a resume and get a job. It's going to be, you know, as you already talked about, it's going to be through contacts, through people you know, through networking. But the best networking isn't people that you just kind of meet. The best networking is people that you've worked with that see your work ethic, that see you produce and see how passionate you are about football. That's how you get. That's how you move up. And you know, to me, it's you know, football. It's a tough job because it's a lot of hours. I think the computer can help you as far as making it more efficient. One thing that we have found here is that we're not going to put in a million hours, and then at the end of the week, you know, going into a game day when you're supposed to be fresh and your head's supposed to be clear, so you can you know, make logical decisions at the right time. You can't be sleep deprived when you do that. There's so many coaches that want to. You know, want to work all these hours, and just to say that they worked all the hours and just grind away. There's so much information out there you can have. At some point, you got to sit back and say, you know what, I need sleep. So I think working hard is important, but working efficiently is just as important. Knowing that there's going to be times where you need to step away, and I think some guys make that mistake of overdoing it, just to say that they did it, and at the end of the week, their mind isn't as sharp as it could be heading into a game situation.
Okay. I like the quote though. Don't look for a better job, do a better job. I've never heard that before, so thank you.
Welcome. it's appropriate. I mean, I've seen a lot of guys fall victim to that.
Is there anything you want to tell Jets fans that we haven't like discussed or talked about?
I just think that Jets fans have been great. They've embraced this. You know, we're going to have our ups, we're going to have our downs, and I think they'll be there with us. I have a very big Jets fan in my family. My brother-in-law, he lives just outside of Tampa, and is a lifelong Jets fan. Grew up here in Jersey, and got very, when I called him and told him I had gotten the job, and he got very emotional on the phone. I mean, it was so important to him that, you know, I couldn't believe it that of all the teams, you know, that I ended up coordinating, you know, defense coordinator of, you know, his team he followed for 30 some years. So it's a passionate group, and they've been through a lot. You know, you hear the phrase, you know, same old Jets, but you know, one thing I think we can safely say when you look at last year things, I think we've changed the culture here, and I think same old Jets is a thing of the past.
All right, I think that's all. I think that's everything. So thank you so much. I really appreciate this.
You're welcome. Take care.
Thank you for listening to the exclusive interview I had with Mike Pettine Jr., the defensive coordinator of the New York Jets. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll hope you tune in next time.